So let's take a poll. There are four members of the this crew, Carl, Danny, myself, and Kayla. How many of us have a cell phone bill? I'll go first, since my parents have passed away and I never was on their cell phone bill.
Did they have a cell phone?
I think my dad did, maybe, but not like a smartphone. Danny, how about you? Do you have a cell phone bill? You know, it comes like a little envelope.
Most of my bills just are auto pay.
Okay, well, yeah. Oh, so is your, do you have an auto pay Verizon bill or AT&T?
I have so many things coming in and out.
You don't even know. So you're trying to, you don't even know.
Yeah.
He's trying to deflect.
I would say that you don't. I would go with you do not. Okay.
He doesn't.
Carl's tattling on you right now.
Yeah, this is fun.
Carl, you own your own home, correct? Up there in Duluth?
I do.
Do your parents own your cell phone bill or do you have your own cell phone bill?
I am on the same cell phone bill as my mother, but I pay her.
How much do you pay a month? Just curious. $100, $80, $50?
I think our combined is about 90. So
okay. I was close. 50, yeah, oh, yeah. Okay. All right. All right, Kayla, you're up. You're a full grown ass adult.
Yeah.
And you have a cell phone bill? Ever seen one?
No.
Do you pay your dad or mom? They could use the money.
Do you have?
They could use the money.
I'm just saying.
What is that supposed to
mean? I'm just saying they could use the money. They could use it.
Are they falling on hard times?
No, I'm just saying.
My parents are very generous.
Oh, so they don't even need, the money.
Yeah, they like to support me.
Netflix.
Here we go.
Listen, I pay for the Adobe Cloud.
Oh, wow.
What does that bring?
That gives my dad Photoshop.
And this is why.
I also pay for Disney.
Oh, my God. You're so $5.99. Wow.
They do pay for Netflix and Hulu and YouTube TV. And
HBO.
No, my older brother pays for that one.
Yeah. And this is why we need a camera on Kayla. She's like, I don't want a camera. I'm like, you're getting a camera. Because when she says, I do pay for my Adobe suite, she had her arms up doing this. I'm like, ooh, Adobe.
You know how much that costs? Well, it's mostly for me.
Yes, I do know how much that costs.
It also is mostly for me. So I guess I'm just buying it.
Does your family have an Adobe account?
Yeah.
Not that I'm aware of, but I want to jump on Kayla's now.
I know.
How many
guys
do we get?
Actually, you only get two at the same time.
What?
So.
Yeah.
It's pretty rough. That way. Yeah, they are.
I'm excited. My son Jake he graduates on the 17th.
Let's do the math.
He is 13 days from his own cell phone plan. If I do anything as a parent, it's pushing my kids into adulthood without looking like the guy to my right.
What?
Or the woman in front of me, you mooches. You guys are mooches. Oh, she's jumping on now. She can't help it. Here she comes without a camera.
Incorrect. I just muted myself.
Oh, okay. Yeah. That's where I like you. In mute. You're perfect there.
Okay, start up the show.
Let's go. Knock it out, Jimmy C.
Oh, boy. Which one is it?
Okay, Kayla. Come on.
Joking right now.
Press the button.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Boys High School Rink of Fire podcast. Tonight's pod is sponsored by Jack's Cafe, three generations of great food for any special occasion. The Red and Black League, the largest boys and girls high school league in Minnesota. And Summit Orthopedics, 11 locations throughout the Twin Cities and specialists ready to treat any sports injury. And now, here's Danny, Carl, and Tony.
Love is a burning thing, and it makes a fiery ring. Bound by wild desire, I fell into a ring of fire.
Good morning, everyone.
We really need a video of all our heads just sort of bouncing very slowly to Ring of Fire.
Yes, I think we do. I think we do. Well, that was our funniest cold open. I called the Franz's poor.
Yeah.
And other than that, you know, it's been a good morning so far.
Yes, yes.
We have a lot on tap today. Kind of our first full week, right?
Yeah.
I mean, and we even had cancellations on Monday or Tuesday.
Tuesday.
So next week will be our first full week. But we had some juicy Class A's. We learned a lot in Class A. And Double A, I just can't wait, Carl. I mean, hopefully you wore the knights with the armor?
Chainmail?
Whatever the thing they wear.
Yeah, chainmail.
You should have that on today because you are going to just get
pounded. I'm really excited when we get to about 6 and 7 in the rankings today.
I think I saw someone this weekend. I said, if Edina beats Benilde, Carl's going to be in a lot of trouble rankings-wise on Saturday night. And shazam, it happened.
Here we go.
Yep.
It happened.
Then throw in the little Maple Grove Stillwater result for that, too.
Oh, I haven't even seen that one.
You
just gave it away.
Oh,
yeah, don't ruin that one for me.
I just knew they were super old and super experienced. I'm like, man, it could be good. They could be good. So, all right, before we do that, let's dive into some news and rankings and all the other good stuff of the show.
Sure. Yeah. So not a whole lot on the news circuit this week, but a couple things to mention. Got Jack Nevers back. You know, we talked about him some last week and I think we had a longer timeline projected at the time, but he is back and playing for Edina. So good
2 points
there.
Last night.
Yeah. So, he was full speed last night.
Mm-hmm. Then the other injury update that we've been following here, Landon Gunderson of Maple Grove. Of course, we think back with Maple Grove, and now it looks like we're looking at more of a late January, early February return for him.
Which is really hard for Landon due to the fact that it is his draft year. So this would have been a good year for him to have 80 points. Like
to rise and
last
shine.
Year. Yeah. So it's too bad.
Yeah, and then finally we have some sort of situation around the Moorhead Radio and their broadcast rights at Hagel. What went on with that game there?
So here's what I know to be fact, and I don't really want to get into too much details because I haven't had a chance to contact Ted Schultz, the athletic director at Minnetonka High School. But I do know that Bally Sports had a full broadcast for their girls game against Andover in the last 2 weeks. So we do know that an outside organization was allowed in, permitted to broadcast there. And I do know, based on the internet, that the Moorhead Spuds Hall of Fame broadcaster, Larry, I don't know his last name, I've met him a few times, super nice guy, was not allowed to broadcast. So anyone in Moorhead driving around in their pickup truck or whatever was not allowed to listen to that game yesterday to a Moorhead broadcast.
So that was radio, not competing video feed, right?
Yes, listen. Well, I said driving around, unless they have their iPad up.
Just radio.
They're just driving around the city.
Both games, Tony. Girls played before boys, and it went to overtime. Letter,
so they did not get a chance to listen to that game. Just stating a fact, that doesn't seem fair or doesn't seem right. And it's the old pick on, you know, and of course it came out on the internet as this, you know, picking on the northern people. I just don't think it's fair. Oh, we have this big, you know, cable conglomerate. We'll let them in, but we won't let the little guy in, broadcast to people back in their small town to listen to on the radio. I mean, we weren't talking about, are we talking video here? I mean, it wasn't even video. So that's not right. Hopefully that can get correct in the future. That's just my take on that piece of news.
Mm-hmm. All right. In that case, I think it's time for our Jeff Cafe Top 10 AA and A.
Ooh. Oh.
Hungry.
I'm hungry, and I'm thirsty for some coffee, too.
For rankings? You hungry for rankings?
Hungry? No, I'm hungry to kill you, but you are going to get killed today, Carl.
I've accepted my page.
You are going to get murdered today.
Well, let's talk about Jax before the murdering.
Before the slaughter. Let's drink up to
before we kill.
Let's drink up to Jax Cafe. This is a good mug, too, by the way. This is solid. I like it. I'm going to have a little sip. Oh.
So these are their coffee mugs at Jax Cafe. You can get them, too. They sell them.
I love them.
You have to send me one of those.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Maybe
in your microphone camera gift pack you're getting this week, you'll get a Jack's Cafe
mug.
I like that. Ooh, good idea.
That would be the real prize there.
I like it.
One of the things that I saw, Jack's Cafe's backyard is completely Christmas themed now. So I get over there. It's really cool.
Yeah, there's 20 days till Christmas, right? So good chance to go over and get a gift card there.
Yep.
They every Saturday, so yesterday, next Saturday, and the following Saturday, they're going to have Christmas with Santa. So you can go there over the lunch hour, brunch hour, have a good brunch, and get your pictures
good,
taken
great
with
brunch.
Santa. Oh, unbelievable.
Their brunch is the best.
I had brunch there a few weeks ago with Peter and my family, and Peter was basically like the older brother in the whole crew in this
show. So Peter was kind of like the phone plan person of your family?
No, he pays his own phone bill too.
No, no, Peter was just accepting the gracious gift that
was the free. Yeah, he was the phone plan there, yeah. He definitely was the mooch for sure. But yeah, we had an awesome brunch there. We kind of all ordered something differently and kind of shared a little bit. There were some good items on that brunch menu. Check out Jack's Cafe. Thanks for their sponsorship of today's ranking.
Okay, let's go, Carl.
I'm scared of Tony's liquidly, but
this is more a statement of how crazy it is, Carl, and not your rankings.
Number one, Minnetonka.
Okay, number one, yeah, correct.
That's easy.
That was really easy. Yeah. They're the best.
At least there's one.
Maybe Andover.
Andover number two?
Maybe.
Oh.
No, he's shaking. Oh, no. Why is that? Because they didn't lose.
Yeah.
Number two is Rogers.
Wow.
I'm not there yet. Oh.
Didn't Wyzetta win last week?
Beat Lakeville South?
Didn't Wyzetta? Oh, but Wyzetta doesn't have as good a win as
Lakeville South, correct. Especially their signature win. Well, we'll get to them.
All right.
Number three is Wyzetta.
Okay, I'll give you that.
Okay.
Number four is Andover.
Okay. All right.
Number five, Lakeville South.
Oh, I think that's really high.
I think that's
well.
Generous.
Wait till you hear number six and seven and eight.
Okay, first before you start to this 6-7-8 run, which is a rough one. Did at any time you consider the word Shakopee in your lingo? Did at any time did you consider Shakopee in your top 10?
No.
I knew it. He's such a snob.
They played one game. They beat an okay team.
Who beat Edina? Who beat
Benilde?
Okay. Oh, sorry. Just saying.
Number six. Number six.
Yep.
St. Thomas Academy.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah yeah. I'm on that for sure.
They passed the eye test for that too.
Six is high, but considering six what happened high. Last week,
yeah,
I'm okay with where that is. I think that's maybe the highest they get this year. But
yeah,
wouldn't doubt it. And the other thing I'll add is they won two section games, so they are in great shape in 3AA.
Yep, no arguing that. Mm-hmm. All right,
number seven, Moorhead.
Oof.
2-3 team.
Oof. Who lost to, didn't they lose to Maple Grove?
No, Andover.
No,
but this year.
Yes.
Didn't Maple Grove beat Moorhead?
No.
No, they didn't.
No.
Okay, all right. Because I know
that. Losses are to Wyzetta, Andover, Minnetonka, so they're all top four teams.
Okay, got it. All right, got it. All right.
Number eight.
Shakopee.
White Bear Lake.
Holy no.
They barely beat Centennial, Eastview beat 7-4.
No. No.
No.
Nope.
No.
No. No. Where's the Sharpie? Literally, we need a Sharpie.
Yeah. This is...
Sorry. Okay. Now it's just going to get worse. This is just going to get worse.
Yeah.
Who would win between Maple Grove and White Bear Lake if they played today?
Running timed.
Who would win?
Just running timed.
I'm just asking a simple question. Who's going to win that game?
probably Maple Grove.
Okay, all right. No further questions, Your Honor. No further questions.
We're done with this line of questions.
Mr. Carl, continue.
We will have a Stillwater Common Opponents by Tuesday, so...
Do they play?
Yes.
White Bears?
Yeah.
Okay. Tuesday. All right.
Yep.
All right. Keep going.
9 is Maple Grove.
Oh, I was close. I was close. And I know I'm right. I just know I am.
Yeah.
All right. I give you that. And yeah. All right. Oof. All right. Mm-hmm. What's 10?
Finally, Benilde.
Shakopee?
Benilde.
Shakopee.
Don't worry.
Ooh. We talked in the car today.
Low scoring, both games, they'll be fine.
Yeah, we talked in the car. You thought they were a firm 10, Danny, in the car.
Yeah, but I also thought that Benilde was the second best team I've seen this year.
Yeah, and so Shakopee's good, too.
Yeah, I think Shakopee's win is not getting enough credit here right now.
All right. Did Shakopee end up in your 11 through 15?
Nope. I don't overreact to one game. That's just the rule.
Well, I wouldn't call this an overreaction of one game. I think their roster is really good.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Carl, good luck.
Okay.
Good luck, Calvin. I know you're listening. You're a top 10 team to us.
Yeah, in our heart.
Right here.
Isn't that cute?
Yep.
Yeah.
Class A?
Where's Benilde?
Edina can't have them still in their 11.
What?
Then Edina, then Benilde.
What?
No. Shakopee? Not in the... Where is Shakopee?
Where is Shakopee?
17.
Who's above them?
Who's above Shakopee?
Eden Prairie, Creighton, Stillwater.
Creighton?
We talking Creighton?
Maybe Eden Prairie.
Okay. I like Creighton, but
I'm not yet.
They're so banged up. All right. Let's move on to Class A. And if you need to take a break, Carl, and get some tissue or gauze pads, feel free.
No. I'm just watching all these bullets fly around me in crazy directions, and none of them are coming close to me, so I'm fine.
Coming close?
We're Stillwater.
14.
I like that.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. What do you got next, Class A?
Class A. Courtesy of Class A guy. Number one, you know what he's going to do.
Oh, for sure. Now he's got ammo.
Yeah, it's Herm.
Yep. It's Hermantown.
And... How deserved? I need to step out for a second. How deserved is this number one ranking now after what they just did?
I think
Buried.
Talk amongst yourselves. I gotta grab some.
I think they are. Period. Number one. Yeah.
I think
Tony has left the building.
Yeah. No, I thought they played very well this last weekend. And when I saw them play on Friday, they looked like a Hermantown team that didn't lose the plants. Or Ty Hansen, and that was the difference maker with that. Okay.
Yeah, when you consider the turnover they had to be not missing a beat, that's a large trophy.
Okay, thank you, Tony. You're not wearing a headset. I'll hold this. Okay. What?
All right.
Okay.
What are we seeing?
Yeah. Right. What are?
I'm pulling up the trophy.
Do you know this is a podcast?
I know.
They can't.
Oh, it's over here. Sorry.
What's over here? Where? Can we describe what's going on? You're out of breath.
I'm going to read you some names
here. Tired.
Okay.
I'm going to read some names here.
This is heavy.
Here we go. Here's who won the 2017 Squirtacular.
Deep breath, Tony.
Will Esther Brooks. River Freeman, Henry Peterson, Holden Evgen, Nolan Barker, Dallas Few, Drew Nelson, Josh Kalpman, Weston Bowman, Evan Gunderson, Brody Matthews, Cody Kalkbrenner.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, that was very heavy.
Did you hear Max Plant's name? Did you hear
no.
Hanson's name? Did you hear Zan Plant's name?
No.
Yeah, because they weren't on that team.
That is the
core that won that Squirtec team. That core is what won those two games this weekend.
Yeah, and they were very important. I don't think it needed this full demonstration that you went through and the heavy breathing that has ensued. But yes, I agree.
I'm just saying.
Did Hermantown win the Champions Cup?
Who won the Champions Cup?
No comment. We haven't awarded the Champions Cup yet. I think I'm going to retroactively change some things to the Champions Cup now. after they mocked me. Basically, Hermantown mocked the system the last 2 years. So I think I'm going to, when I get the new trophy base, this just in, I'm going to put Hermantown's name on it both. Because they won both varsity games the last 2 years.
What happened to the trophy base?
It got broke. That should be in the news and nuggets. That's all I'm gonna say. The trophy based team who won last year was broken. I did retain the cup, but that's it. So I believe I'm going to just go to a varsity platform next year. No more JV because JV screws everything up.
Oh.
And I'm just gonna put Hermantown's name on the cup for the both first 2 years because they went 2-0. The only varsity team to go 2-0 in both years. So I'm just gonna put their name on the cup and make it a varsity trophy. End of story. Next topic. Who's number two?
Warroad.
Nice try to smooth transition. Warroad's number two.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. We'll get to them later.
Mm-hmm. Number three is Matavidai.
Okay. I'm still there.
I feel like we could record this podcast for the last 4 years and have the exact same thing.
It's always
record, you know, until we get to. Well, we will have a moment at some point between now and January when Hermantown loses to a top five double A team in a close Christmas game.
I sure
game,
hope
right?
so.
Yeah. We got to move them. I'm like, they just lost a Cretan. Why are we moving them off of the top spot? Yeah. Remember? I don't know.
I remember that.
So.
Okay. Who's number four?
Number four is Orono.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm here for that. I'm up here for that for sure. Have you seen them, Danny?
No, because the Tuesday game got
snowstorm.
Yeah, which is disappointing.
Who are they playing?
Northfield. So that's a really
gosh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, games that I wish I could attend. That's the one that I wish I could have back.
Yeah, who did I? Oh, I had a girls Dodge County South St. Paul blizzard me out. So two teams that'll be in the state tournament. That's why I was up. It's kind of the same thing with this Orno.
Yeah.
You know, Orno Northfield thing. So
okay.
Number five, Providence Academy.
Sure. You saw them.
I saw them. They're good. They're legit.
Yeah, I can get behind that.
Yep.
Number six, East Grand Forks.
Not quite there yet, but I think it's a steep hill after those five.
I don't think it's as steep as you think.
I've seen East.
Unless he's got Alexandria at seven, then the hill is steep.
Okay. Who's seven?
That was Northfield.
Yep.
Okay.
Number eight, Deep River Falls.
I just think he's stretching there.
Yeah,
he's last year they made the section final. This will look good.
And they have a good win over St. Cloud Cathedral.
Yep.
But it was a 2-0 win, and I'm less high on Cathedral right now.
Danny,
the luster has come off Cathedral.
You and I did these Class A's the last few years or whatever, and we were always 8, 9, 10, just guessing.
It's a struggle.
You know, you get to 6, 7, they're pretty easy, and then
Cambridge screwed everything up this week.
They had it all. They would have made his life really easy.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I agree.
Okay, Carl?
Number 9 is Alexandria.
Yeah. Okay. 10 is Waconia, maybe?
I don't think so, but they're getting heavy consideration. They're undefeated.
Yeah, and they've won
and they beat Cambridge.
And they beat Breck, which is – but it's a big section motivating win. I'm not saying
they're not the same section, though.
Aren't they?
Cambridge and Breck?
No, Waconia.
Oh, Waconia and Breck, yes. Agreed.
Okay, Carl.
10 is Detroit Lakes.
They had a bad week.
I don't know exactly what they did, but they know they didn't.
I noted their scores.
All right,
good. They didn't have a great week.
Good. All right. I like that.
Okay. Well, that is the top 10. Tony, you want to take away Red Black League Coach's Corner interview with Hermantown's head coach, Pat Andrews?
Thank you, Danny. We're joined now with Patrick, or Pat Andrews, Hermantown head coach the last five seasons and a state champion. Congratulations. I won the title last year, Pat.
Thanks.
Yeah. We have a short amount of time here today with could be a 2-hour podcast. We're going to condense this down to 30. Let's just talk about where you grew up. I know a lot of your story, but you grew up, you're a hawk for life, essentially. Talk about your childhood growing up in Hermantown.
Yeah, I born and raised, you know, born in a hospital in Duluth and raised my whole life in Hermantown. I grew up in the same house from birth to 18 when I left home and went to college. So I grew up in Hermantown, probably, you know, started hockey when I was 4, 1984, in Hermantown. And at that time, the rink was across the street by the YMCA today. And that's where I learned how to skate. It was on that rink with a line of Christmas lights down the middle of the rink kind of type look. And then when I was right in that era, like within a year or two, it moved across the street to the current location, but still no arena. So they built two new rinks outdoor there with what is still part of our arena, the concession stand / warming shack on the back.
By the
south
rink rats,
side,
right? Yeah.
Yeah. It was there. It's been there ever since. And so that's where I grew up then learning hockey. And then the rink was built in 88 when I was 8. I was a squirt.
So where did the Hawks, where did you play high school games?
High school was at Proctor or at Pioneer Hall, you know, the old deck.
Really?
Yeah. So they
where
never
did
had
you
a
practice.
Rink. They practice outside or at Proctor or at Pioneer Hall at 6 in the morning. So they had a lot of, and
let
through,
that
the,
settle
through
in,
the
right?
early 80s, they had outdoor practice. Dave Huddle, who runs the rink, they practiced outside all the time where the current rink is. And then that somewhere in the 80s, they started practice. So if you look back at old pictures when Bruce started coaching, the team photo was taken at Proctor Arena.
Okay.
And then
Old Proctor.
Yep. Yeah. And then, 88, we got a rink. So that was a game changer, obviously, for our program.
Where were you in 1988?
I was a squirt. I scored the first goal ever in the rink. It was New Year's Day. And there
Is
was
there a plaque?
There was a squirt tournament. There's no plaque. We have the puck from the first high school goal. Ryan O'Leary scored it. Played for Denver, Calgary Flame draft pick. Cousin of mine, actually.
Really?
Yeah. He scored the first high school goal.
Okay,
I grew up playing there all the way through high school, and then I graduated high school, went to St. John's, and played for Coach Harrington at St. John's for just a year.
That your freshman year?
My freshman year.
And then I think you're a UMD grad, aren't you?
No, I graduated from St. John's.
You wear UMD sweatshirts a lot, my friend. So
yeah, we're all Bulldogs fans up north.
All right. Okay, so where did you go? Where did you get your degree then?
I got my degree from St. John's,
okay.
History. And then
just
I
played
got,
1 year.
Just played 1 year.
Okay, got it.
And then
got
I got
it.
A teaching license, well, my master's in education from Scholastica.
So. Okay, got it. What point of your life did coaching enter your brain?
I would say probably high school.
High school?
You know, I had such a great high school experience, and I kind of realized in my junior, senior of high school that I thought I wanted to go into teaching. And at that time, I thought I was going to go into elementary education. So it's kind of why I got off track a little bit, not why I finished at Scholastica with a history degree at St. John's, finished my education stuff at Scholastica, because I started out in elementary, realized I didn't want to elementary teach, and kind of had a year where I didn't know for sure what I wanted to do, because I realized I didn't want to be in an elementary classroom. So then I ended up going into secondary ed and history, right. And I love it. And that's been great. But the coaching side, I realized pretty young that this was pretty awesome. And then obviously, as we've talked about in the past, my dad died when I was 16. And it was kind of my senior year, I realized like how amazing our community was and just that support going through it. You realize it, but with a couple of years of perspective, I was kind of like, this is pretty awesome. And I probably wouldn't be where I am without, you know, Bruce Plant or my soccer coach, Paul Solstrom, or Dave Thompson, who's now the soccer coach and guidance counselor. Like those people are pivotal people in my life. And I was like, man, teaching is kind of cool. You get to have a pretty cool, you know, to teach and coach would be a pretty cool deal to be able to, you know, be involved in other kids' lives. Cause it's fun. Kids are fun. You know, I mean, young people are fun. There's energy there, you know, it's positive. It's, they just have an energy that adults don't have. You know,
right. They haven't been sapped. Hasn't been sapped out of them yet. Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's go back to your father passing away. What did your father do for a living?
He was like blue collar as it comes. My dad was, you know, never finished high school, actually.
Yeah.
Back
Did he grow up in Hermantown?
Nope. He grew up in Duluth.
Okay.
Kind of all over Duluth. Very poor. You know, very, very poor family. Knew that when he had kids, they were going to graduate high school one, but they were going to go to college. So my sister and I are both first generation college grads. And
it's just you and your sister?
Yeah. Okay. And so just like instilled him and my mom, just instilled education and giving back like hardcore. And so my dad wasn't a hockey guy by trade by any means.
But learned I've seen on the pictures fly. Of him coaching.
Yeah.
Right?
So
okay. All right.
My sister was into horses. So he did 4-H with my sister all the way up and built a barn in our backyard because we had 12 acres of land in Hermantown. It was a dirt road. I grew up with cattle across the street. I mean, the community's changed
today.
So much.
Yeah, I was going to say that.
And my sister wanted to get into horses. So he just is like, all right, we're going to do horses. And he built a barn by his scratch.
Really?
And my sister did horses all the way through high school. And then I loved hockey. And my dad was a gearhead by trade. And he raced cars and snowmobiles and stuff. And so that was his deal. But his kids had other interests. And so then my dad threw himself into hockey. And I remember sitting watching my dad read USA Hockey. There used to be like USA Hockey manuals. Remember those?
Yeah.
Like red books?
Yeah. Yep.
He would sit there and painstakingly read. He wasn't a reader, but he did so he could coach. So like I watched my dad, who had no real background in hockey, learn enough hockey to coach me through squirts. And that was really important to him.
That's
so
super cool.
That's where my love of coaching kind of comes from. My dad was a great coach, even though he didn't know a lot. He's super patient. So I try to be patient, but
yeah.
Not as patient as he was.
Really?
Yeah.
I think if you're patient.
Oh, I appreciate that. And I try to be, but I mean, he was a very patient person when it came to teaching. Like I was just in the garage with him from a little kid all the way up, little. And he was patient enough. Like he'd be in the middle of working something. He'd take time to like show you, you know, a crescent wrench or this or how to fix that. And like, I try to be that way, but my kids would probably tell you I'm not as patient, you know?
Got it. How did he pass away? What was the
lung cancer?
So he
smoked from age 11, you know, back in the day, you know, impoverished family.
Yeah.
Just live hand to mouth, you know, literally not off the street, but like, yeah, they fended for themselves a lot. So they were into everything and
yeah.
Just picked up smoking at a young age. And
so, how long did he go through the battle?
Probably close to three years.
So basically
like
your adolescence was kind of robbed by the fact that you might be losing your dad someday.
Yeah. And so it's weird to look back on that a little bit, Tony, because I don't think I realized how bad it was, honestly. I mean, my mom didn't lie to me. My family didn't lie to me, but I think they sheltered me a little bit from how bad it was. But looking back on pictures, I'm like, oh, how did I not see? I mean, he was not a big guy. He was like 5'5", but by the end of it, he probably weighed 80 pounds.
Oh,
you know? And you don't, when you're with them every day, you don't realize it. So I wouldn't say my childhood was robbed for me. In some ways, yeah, I feel robbed in the fact that like he wasn't around to see my kids and see that stuff. But for those 2.5 years, he was around every day because he couldn't work for most of it. I got to be around him a ton. So I don't look at it as being robbed. But at the same time, yeah, it's hard.
No, I'm just saying your average 15-year-old's thinking about the school dance or hockey practice.
Well, I still was too, but that's a great thing about being a teenager. It comes back to this. Like teenagers, I love them, but they are so, you know,
right.
Like teenagers are here.
Blinders.
My group of friends, my life, because that's where your brain's at.
Yep.
And that's true. I didn't realize totally how, you know, sick he was.
All right, now I gotta fast forward.
Yeah, sorry.
One of the greatest moments in my career was watching you plugging in a DVD.
Yeah.
Showing me the 1998 section final. Was it at the deck?
No, it was at Cloquet.
Cloquet. Okay. I knew it was in the area, right? Because I knew it was a Duluth TV station.
Yeah.
Puts the camera in your face. This is how many, with a year or within a year of your dad passing away?
A year and a half or so. Yeah,
right?
Something like that.
Your dad passes away. You score game-winning goal to send the Hawks to the state first ever trip.
Nope.
Second. I remember there might have been like 90, whatever.
94.
So second trip to state. You and your buddies are going to state and you got the goal.
Yeah.
And go through. I wish I had clips of it.
Yeah.
Andy.
It's embarrassing. But yeah. I mean, it is.
It's
one of
the coolest
to everyone else.
It made hockey land.
It did make
hockey land. When I walked out of hockey land, I said, well, at least I got the Pat Andrews speech thing right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, that's a surreal moment in someone's life. And I don't even know if I remember it because I've seen that video and like video of the newscast of that night. That game is such a blur in my head. I remember being incredibly nervous. I thought I played terrible, you know, but we had a really good team. Proctor had a really good team, And it was just kind of an epic battle that came down to the end. And we actually had a power play at the end. And I still remember seeing that pass come across the slot. Reed Malik put a perfect pass right in the tape, and it was just right in the wheelhouse. And I one-timed it, and I just, the rest is a blur. It hit the net, you know? And
yeah,
I mean, it was pretty remarkable.
You had so
feeling.
Much hair too.
I had unbelievable. We're just talking about my son has the same
hair. He's got
hair,
the same hair.
And it's just huge right now. I'm like, he's like, I should cut it. I'm like, don't ever cut it.
Don't cut it.
Yeah. I mean, it was
your father told you about crescent wrenches. You taught him about hair.
Yeah. So, I mean, that is one of those moments that I said it in that video, I'm pretty sure, but you do literally dream of that moment as a kid growing up in Minnesota, and then to have that happen is beyond surreal and emotional. And the piece of my dad dying was definitely part of that too, you know? So I
brought up Hockey Land and figure let's just talk about it for a second. What was your take on it? I really enjoyed it. I
thought it was great. The first time I watched it, I called Tommy. I'm like, I don't know, man, this is, because, I mean, I'm screaming at kids within 5 minutes of the film starting. I'm like, are you kidding me? He's like, just give it a chance. You got to watch the whole film. And I had watched it basically just at home. We hooked up the iPad to the TV. It was just my family. So it was I don't know. But then I saw it a second time in a theater with everybody. Yeah. And people were kind of blown away. And I was like, had some time to digest it. And I thought they did a really good job.
I really enjoyed it. And I tweeted about it, too. My only disappointment was that Bruce didn't make it. This is a vital part of the community, and John Masich didn't make it on the. And it wasn't that I was mad. I'm like, if I could weave those two men into the
for
story,
sure.
That was it. But I didn't leave empty. I was like,
right.
And then I said, I talked to him afterwards. I go, hey, I couldn't write a complete fluff piece about the thing because I was really positive. It's because it is awesome.
Yeah.
But I had to say something.
Yeah.
You know, you had to put a little, you know, in there for people to believe how good it was, and it was fantastic.
And I talked to Tom about that same exact thing, you know, just a little bit more about the history or whatever. And he's like, where do you stop? How do you stop? Especially in Eveleth, it's so long and rich. And then ours is newer, but he's like, how do you stop? Where do you go? And the biggest thing I thought was cool about it is I think two pieces. One, somebody who's not a hockey fan could watch that movie and enjoy it.
Yep.
If you're in Alabama.
Yep.
And you could get a glimpse at what we live through in Minnesota. The snow, the sound of snow when it's cold out, all of that stuff. And then I think for hockey people, it brings back those memories, the yellow school bus, the frosted windows, coming back on the road trip, you know, like all those things.
Snowblower,
like,
the whole thing is fantastic.
I thought they did a great job. It was a very surreal thing. My biggest thing, and I told Tom from beginning, is just please don't sewer us. Like, it'd be so easy to make us out to be, you know.
Evil.
And he didn't. I think it's presented, and obviously we're successful, but I think
he did such
a great job with the boys and the four stories that it humanized the whole thing.
And it's fantastic.
I loved it. I thought it was pretty cool.
I love it. All right. Let's talk a little bit about Pat's, run through Bantams as a coach. How long did you coach in the youth association before you jumped into the high school?
Well, 10, 12 years. I don't remember exactly. Because
what did you coach? I know you was Bantam AA guy, but did you coach before that?
So I graduated in 2002, went right back and started volunteering assistant with the high school. So I volunteered assistant for 4 years under Bruce. And the Bantam job came open, and I talked to him, like, should I do it or I stay with you? Like, ultimately, I want to be a head coach. But he's like, if you're never a head coach, you'll never be a head coach.
Right.
He's like, go be the Bantam head coach and learn how to coach. Or you can just watch me, but that's not the same thing. So
did you guys have, because I know it even goes back to Franny, that you didn't allow, Bruce didn't allow him. Was it nice for him to have you there to like, hey, I got your basically varsity coach here, but he's going to be coaching the 13 and 14 year old kids. So
yeah, I don't know that that was ever said, but I will say we have had amazing consistency with our Bantam coaching staffs.
Yeah.
Because the guy I took over for had been there for like 15 years.
Right.
And I did it for 10 or 12. I think we've only had four or five Bantam coaches in the last 25, 30 years, which is unheard of.
Yeah.
But it creates tremendous continuity. And we've all had great relationships with Bruce. So like,
that helps. I
had played for Bruce. He was one of my friends. He got me through, you know, some of the hardest moments of my life. And so we had a great relationship. So we talked hockey and what he wanted all the time. And I have that relationship with Grant now, the Bantam coach. So I think that continuity is huge. But yeah, I started coaching Bantams around 2005-ish. No, 2006, 7, somewhere in there. 2006, 7.
And were you on the staff 16 and 17, or were you still coaching Bantam?
17, yes.
At 16, no. Yes. Right, okay. Yep. So you experienced it. You had the medal put on your head, and you had an unbelievable team coming back in 18 as well.
Yeah, I mean, we graduated. That was Sandy's group, Sandy and Sandberg and Jocko, and those guys were seniors. So I got, it was really cool for me is I got to coach those guys in Bantams. And then their senior year, I got to come back, and I was on staff. I think he
took consolation champs with those guys in 14,
we lost
right?
a kid named Casey Middlestad. Who
in the consolation game?
In triple overtime. So to tell you how, I mean, this is one of the coolest stories ever. I see Gertie all the time, right? We'll see him this weekend coaching Bantam, you know, at EP.
Another Bantam coach. Yep.
And so Casey Middlestad beat us in triple overtime, bar down, backhand. It was a hat trick. Dylan Sandberg jumped on his back and Casey still went bar down. That tells you how much Dylan's growing. Cause Dylan
wasn't
5'9" second year Bantams and now he's 6'3".
Yeah.
But, you know, so like, but the amount of talent on the ice that game or other games, or I just found a picture. I sent it to Adam Scherer, who was the coach at Elk River the year prior.
Now.
Yeah. And so I sent him a picture of an outdoor game we did with Elk River, and Cole Koepke and Purbix are on the ice together in a picture on the outdoor rink at Hermantown. And now they're playing together at Tampa Bay. Like, it's just surreal to see. No, it's surreal to see how special Minnesota hockey is and see where these kids go. You know, you're coached with or you coached for these kids or coach against them in these Bantams.
Yeah.
And they all go on, and to watch them in the NHL is just amazing. Every night you turn on the TV and there's someone, you either their coach from Hermantown, which is beyond crazy, or someone you coached against playing every night.
He's still doing that thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I know what he's going to do here. You can actually see those habits, you know?
Yeah, I know. All right. Let's talk a little bit about your coaching role. You came in, and there's a lot of disappointment here. I mean, 18, you lose to Alexandria in the semifinals, which was a big upset. Mm-hmm. 19, you lose to Greenway.
Yeah.
20, you lose one of the more epic state finals ever to Matamidi. 21, you had to go through the – I was there that day when you found out about the COVID. Do you remember that? Yeah. That was literally 5 minutes after I saw you.
Yeah.
You found out literally within that time. Yep. I'm coming back. I was like in Moose Lake or something, and my phone's blowing up. And I'm like, what's going on? He goes, something's going on in Hermantown. I'm like, I was just there 35 minutes ago. What? I don't know what's going on. And you had just called a team meeting. So that must have been awful. And then last year, you finally got over a great win over World. So walk through some of those disappointing times and what you learned from that.
Sure. You know, one thing before we move on, I'm sorry, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention, you know, one of the years I coached Bantams, I got to coach with Mike Sertich, the old Bulldog coach. And I just want to bring Serti up because he's just diagnosed with cancer and I love the guy to death. And I just would be remiss if I didn't, you know, just, he's a huge part of who I am as a coach too.
How did you meet him? How did that connection go?
Make this interview going longer.
No, that's fine.
But long story longer, I remembered him from like a Bible church camp that I was at, like a day camp when I was like 5, and he spoke to us.
Really?
And I remember meeting him then, and then just like our lives just kept like intersecting at times. And he's UMD coach, so he's around, right? And then I did a camp called UMD Quick Camp, which at that time was like the only summer option in Duluth to skate. And I was fortunate enough to get in there, which is a whole nother story for another time.
Yeah.
I met Jim Knapp and Serti, and that was like, I was probably a Bantam, and he never forgets anybody. And so, and every time I run into him, we talk and talk hockey, and then he ended up coaching Bantams at Hermantown, and was just in, like done at Michigan Tech, but still wanted to coach, and somebody knew him, and he's like, would you come coach, Bantams at Hermantown?
He said,
like,
yes.
Yeah, let's do it. So then I got to coach with Serti, and it was unbelievable. I spent a year coaching with Mike Sertich, and it was like getting a master's degree in it, in coaching. I mean, I traveled in a truck. He would pick me up and we'd drive to Fargo, which is him and I in the cup of coffee talking hockey, and unbelievable. Changed. I wouldn't say it changed, but introduced so many different things to the game of hockey I never even knew.
What's one of them, Pat?
Creativity. Just unbelievable. He's like, well, what do you want to work on? I'm like, well, I don't know. I have this dream. He's like, not drill. What do you want to work on? So we talk about we need to work on it, and then he's just like, well, let's make up a drill for that. And we just like make up drills on the fly, not like something you'd ever seen, just like a drill to work on that specific thing. And his creativity of flow and, you know, getting kids out of lanes. And so I really try not to use, we talk a lot about using the depth of a rink, different depths of the rink and different widths of the rink, but we're trying to constantly move and create space and all these things that are kind of pretty much common knowledge now. Certainly was, you know, introducing to me 20 years ago, 15 years ago. And so that was amazing. So that was a big piece of my coaching. So I had Bruce's element of just, he's such a blue collar, hard work guy. And then I had Serdy, who's such a thinker. I mean, I'm blessed to have those both. It's crazy because I know I wouldn't be the coach I am without both those influences, you know? So not that I was ready to take over for Bruce, because I don't know if anybody's ready. But right. Yeah, then we go into 18 off of that.
And, yeah. So it's interesting. We just one quick note on Bruce, and I spent, you know, a few days with you guys, whatever, I don't know, 8-10 years ago now. Yeah. It was an awesome experience for me. But one of my takeaways of Bruce was he was a father figure and a brother figure all wrapped into one. I was there one day when I was with him, and the guys would come in, and you'd get one piece of, hey, how's it going? Slap on the back. You know, I'm giving you a hard time like a brother would or an older brother would. But then there was always this, like, there was this respect that you had for him as well. So you kind of could kid him, but you could also get some information from him. What was your takeaway? What was your experience with Bruce all those years?
I would agree 100% and respect/fear in some ways.
Right. Like,
especially as a sophomore, he terrified me. Like, I actually would go, and I've told him this before, I went home my sophomore year and I hated the guy. Like, I'm like, what? Like, he's so hard, so harsh on his expectations. But looking back on it now, I realize, like, he knew I could be better. And he had, you know, big expectations for me as a sophomore. And by my senior year, I mean, I loved the guy. And he was a huge mentor in my life. And he was somebody I could just go in and talk to. And his office was always open. And it's definitely something I've taken away from him. Like, my office door is always open. If it's shut, there's a reason for it. Other than that, it's open. Guys come in and out. And, but yeah, you're absolutely right. Cause there was that respect thing. You didn't dare not respect him. He could command a room, but at the same time, there was like this softness to him too, that most people didn't see, but there was definitely a fear. Like, you could drop the hammer.
I for sure saw the softness that the Jared Thomas and LeBlanc walk in, and it was like a frat party. Hey, well, it's good. They were giving each other a hard time, and it was good. Right. I'm like, yeah. And I could also see them 10 minutes later, they get on the ice and he's blowing the whistle. He's got his, one of those like work gloves on wood stick with like electrician's tape on it. And I'm like, this is grandpa out here. Right. He was just a great guy. And I coached once with him up in Calgary for a 4-day thing. And I saw him be that. Yeah. Good old pal, good old buddy. But when he put the hammer down, I mean, even Derek would take a step back.
Oh, he's intense.
He's in a good intense.
Yeah.
You know, and you know where the plants get that from. It's from Bruce, for sure.
Yeah. Well, Christy's pretty damn competitive, too.
She's the athletic side. She's the athletic side. That's what I always say. Yeah. She's the athletic one, and the plants are the drivers, you know.
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit. We have a short amount of time here. This is a different team this year, and I'm not going to rip on the Hawks. I've already stood up for them quite a bit, how good they're going to be this year. But I think I went through my list last night. It's like 6 years in a row where I've come up to Hermantown to interview a player of the year finalist. Think about that. That's crazy. You got Sam and Sandy and Joey and Blake. And you know what I mean? Like, Kelly literally. And Dallas could go off. So I'm not taking Dallas or somebody could go off. But this might be the first year you don't have one of those, you know, generational players. You've had 6 or 7 of them in a row the last few years. I think you're excited about it. Tell me a little bit about this team, because you're going to really roll up those sleeves this year.
Yeah, I mean, the standing joke's been like, we'll see if we can coach. But I think, honestly, we have a great group back. And I think what everyone has to step back and realize is you can't compare groups ever, regardless of how good or whatever you had or haven't had or this or that. Like, it's not a comparison ever. Every group has challenges and every group has things they excel at. And this group is no different. I'm super excited. The only thing is maybe going in this year, there's maybe more question marks about who will step up or who that person will be, but there will be somebody will step up and maybe it'll be a little more of a team effort. I don't know. Like, I'm super excited to see what happens tonight. Like, we've been going super hard in practice, but I want to see who steps up in a game. We need to play some games to see where we're at. And the biggest thing with this group is just telling them, like, effort, just 100% effort. Don't worry about making mistakes. Just make 100% effort, and we're going to grow. And we're going to, you know, make mistakes, because we have a lot of guys who have played some high school hockey, but not in the roles we're asking them to play. And you're going to make mistakes sometimes. That's okay. Like, that's how you learn. And I think they're going to learn a lot, but I think we could be really good by the end. Really good.
Not to jinx you here, but the, and I hate to transform kids from squirts to high school, but this group, without Max Plant, won the hardest squirt tournament, our Squirtacular, when they were in 2017, and they're beating everybody. So these kids, when people, I don't want to discount them.
No.
There's a lot of really good athletic kids.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, we have, I mean, I could go through the list. I mean, we just, I mean, our captains, George and Wyatt and Cade, are phenomenal. Like, they're really, really good hockey players, you know, and they just haven't got some of the glory because there's been other names in front of them, but they're really good hockey players.
You guys do have some great hockey players, and I've really enjoyed an interview today with our head coach from Hermantown High School, Pat Andrews.
Well, thanks, Tony. Thanks, Pat. That was a really good Red Black League Coach's Corner interview. Always kind of cool when we get some fun new coaches, even though it doesn't seem like Pat's been a new coach. You know, he seems like he's been
he's
there
not
for
not that new anymore.
Yeah.
It was weird sitting down right before we went through the disappointments of his early coaching. I mean, before the state title.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Think about that. In 18, they were expected to be in the state final. I wouldn't say they were the favorite, but they were expected to be in the state final. And they lose in the semis. Disappointment, right? 19, they lose to Greenway in the section final. And 20, they lose to Matamide when they should have won. Everybody would agree with that. And then 21, they had the JV experience at the state COVID tournament.
Yep.
You know, that's a rough 4 years for a coach. And I think he's obviously one of those, you know, first-class guys. You know, he's just one of these guys that's always working the rink, right? Yesterday I saw him talking to Coach Satterdahlin. You know, he understands where he sits in this whole landscape, and he knows it's pretty special. Just a super guy.
Let's talk about work in the rink, Red Black League, Tony.
Yeah, I see those guys work in the rink too. We see a lot of Red Black players playing this weekend and playing all over the state. I was over at the Century Holy Angels games. You saw guys there as well. So it's fun to see guys that are kind of working at their craft in the off season and doing it in the Red Black Leagues, thanks to their sponsorship of today's segment.
Okay, let's get to some games last week. We had some good ones, like we said before. It's the first kind of full week, barring the snow.
I saw 6 games, only one bad one.
Yeah, I saw 6 as well, and I didn't see really a bad one. First one I saw this week was Holy Family 3, Edina 2. Big game for the Flyers.
Oh, scored goals.
Yeah, look at the positive.
Look at the positives here. I would say this was a warm-up game for Jackson Nevers. He didn't look as good in this game as he did against Benilde, which is kind of to be expected. But Holy Family also took advantage of that, too.
Tell me what you saw out of Holy Family.
I think they do have some good depth, and I like Parker Osborne.
I was going to say, we're going to hear Parker Osborne's name a lot this year.
I liked him a lot. I think he's a top player for them. I think this is a team that still can cause fits in 2AA.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And we'll see them. They play Eden Prairie later in the year.
How'd you like to be at the 2AA section meeting this year?
Oof. Yeah, this year it's
going to be ugly.
Everything passed
real
one.
Ugly.
Yeah, and this is granted that Tonka doesn't lose to Eden Prairie, you know, because that could happen.
Yeah,
it's going to be ugly.
If Tonka and Eden Prairie split, then that room is going to be just nasty.
Then that's a hard, hard argument.
Yeah, it's still going to be a public school versus private thing. So don't, if you're Holy Family, don't expect good things when you walk in their room.
No. Top 10 Moorhead apparently took Bemidji to overtime in a 4-3 overtime win.
Yeah, no, I think that result is more concerning than any of Moorhead's losses.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, but you know, top 10 teams.
Top 10 teams, get it done. Top 10 teams do that.
Yep.
And they got it done. They won.
Oh.
Yeah, wow.
Okay. Mm. That's how we look.
Mm.
Okay. Yeah, concerning. This was the beginning of a concerning. I saw them play later in the week. They looked better than this outcome. Let's put it that way. Fergus Falls 3, Northern Lakes 1. This is an important, what is it, 6?
Yeah, 6A.
6A score.
I'm glad you read this score because there were, I'm not going to say any specifics, but something happened in the bleachers in that game that I am looking into. So if you were at that game, please contact me. I'm looking into something that might have happened in the bleachers at that game.
Okay. Somebody spit gum underneath the seat. Again.
Sure, sure.
Okay. East Grand Forks 3, Detroit Lakes 2 in overtime.
That's a big score.
It is a big score. It is. Yeah, Detroit Lakes wishes they had this one.
Yeah. You know, you get the Holy Family Shock P.E. Dyna triad. This score here does a lot. It makes rankings easy on the Class A side, where that score makes rankings hard on the Class AA side.
Correct.
Well, it seems to be how it works.
Right, right.
Waconia 2, Breck 1, overtime. This is one of the Waconia scores that I mentioned before.
This is fantastic.
Yeah, it's an important score for Waconia, though.
Yeah, it's great. We got a new team to go. We have to go see.
Yeah, exactly.
Which I love. Kind of like you going to see Cambridge last year. We have to see it, right?
I think I might see Cambridge on Friday. They play Monticello.
Really? That's a good game.
Sure.
Yeah. And it's at Monticello, I believe. Okay. St. Thomas Academy 3, Eastview 0. I was at this one. It was kind of a mirror image of their section semifinal game. I would say the skill level is higher. Between.
A mirror image, but the opposite score.
Yes. Mirror image of skill. Skill level was increased, but still very tight the whole way. A lot of perimeter shots for St. Thomas and Eastview. This game did not capitalize or get in on Magosi.
Right.
But Brothers played well. Opgard played well for Eastview. They're a good team. And, again, St. Thomas is bigger than – if you haven't seen them play, they have size. So.
Savino is enormous.
I know. And then their third or second D pairing of Faith, and I forget who number 4 is, but 4 and 2, the sophomores, they're bruisers out there.
Faith and Russ were over at the Champions Cup.
Yep. Yep. But good win for St. Thomas, but more to come out of 3, I think.
Right.
Rogers 7, Coon Rapids 2.
Well, that's a good score.
It's a good score for Rogers.
Yeah, and it's a good score. Oddly enough, it's a good score for Coon Rapids because in the olden days, that could have been 11-1.
Yeah.
17-2.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, so I think that score is worth noting for that. And then the score that we've been talking about already, Shakopee 3, Holy Family 2. Shakopee is... Carl doesn't believe it, but I think this puts them in a top 10 conversation.
Carl doesn't believe. I just think he's kind of like a snob.
Yeah, it could be.
Carl, you're a snob. Like, it has to be like Duluth East or, you know, like these traditional programs. You know, they have to play the state tournament to make my top 10 rankings. Like, we realize.
Like, can I have them?
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
That's my point, exactly.
They
don't deserve it.
I'm.
They don't deserve it. I ripped that one, too.
Yeah,
but they aren't your top 10. They were once for 1 week.
Yeah.
Yeah. They were crazy.
No, I think this is probably I thought earlier in the week, you know, the Lakeville North game that Shakopee beat Lakeville North. I think that was 2 years ago or maybe it was last year. That was a statement win for them.
Yes.
This is a big statement win for they're beating Holy Family who's taking their players type of thing. And I think That's where this game is important.
I agree.
Cambridge Isanti 4, St. Cloud Cathedral 1. This is kind of the start of the downfall for Cathedral this week.
I thought the Crusade did not go well.
No,
it didn't. I thought the Crusade had a very similar script last year as well. They started slow and finished very strong.
Yeah, and I still think that can happen, but this is a section. This is a 5A section game, and so this is a big win for Cambridge.
Is that a Furniture and Things? Yes, they play at Furniture and Things.
Cambridge does?
Finals at Furniture.
Finals.
Finals.
Oh. I was like, I don't think that's their home ice,
No.
Rochester Mayo 3, Hastings 3, overtime tie.
It's exactly what I expected.
Yeah, which... Yeah.
That's exactly what I expected.
Yeah.
In the battle for the 3 seed in 1AA.
Well, now it's the battle of the 3 seed unless for somehow Mayo beats North. Now that section meeting gets weird.
And that's like is that a February game between?
Yes.
Early February. Yeah.
Okay.
Hill Murray 2, Eden Prairie 1. I liked this game. I thought Hill came out the better team in the first period, and then Eden Prairie woke up in the second and third, and it was a pretty even matchup.
I thought the second period was all Eden Prairie, and the third period was just dead even.
Yeah.
And obviously the face masking call on Hill Murray in the third period gave them a 3-minute power play and then extra man on the
– And it just let it ice it away.
What's that?
It let Hill ice it away.
No, Hill Murray had the face mask. Yeah, are you kidding?
Yeah, sorry.
No, that put them at a huge disadvantage.
Yeah, so
I thought the most of the third period was even until the face masking, 15 personal foul, face masking, 15 yards on Hill Murray.
And we haven't seen a face masking call in a long time.
I have never seen face masking major called in high school hockey. I've seen it
I
called.
Don't think I have.
The Big Ten is just, you could graze a face mask in the Big Ten and they'll call it.
But the face mask literally
came off the hinges.
Yeah, it ripped off. And so I think
there's nothing the refs could do.
Yeah. The writing's on the wall there.
Right. All right, next.
Andover 7, Moorhead 2.
Is that the top three, the most alarming score?
Is Moorhead, wait for it, the Kirk Cousins of high school hockey?
Oh, I like that.
Can't play in prime time.
I like that. Wow, that
if
hurts.
Moorhead played in the 11 o'clock game on Thursday,
they do well.
The night game, Moorhead's losing.
No, I know. I like that. I do like that. It's a good hot take.
Run with that until they prove it otherwise.
I like that.
It's not my only take. That's Grant Fuhr's and Colin Guess's take. On the
oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
All right. Dang,
but I came up with it, but they apparently came up with it before me.
All right.
So I'll give them that. But very good win for Andover, I thought, in the first Bally's game, too.
Yeah, the boys. First boys one, yeah.
Yeah. Orono 4, Little Falls 2. This started Orono's week, which was a jaunting week to start. One of them got canceled. The Northfield got canceled, but this is a good win for Orono.
Yep.
Matamidi 6, East Grand Forks 3. So we can start to see.
Wasn't that game tied early and then Matamidi kind of poured
I think
on?
So. I think that's what that was. I don't have the box score in front of me for that. But this is where you see Matamidi is 3, and then there's a gulf between 3.
As Peter says on the Girl Show, a big ass gap.
That does sound like Peter. in talking about a gap in talent, Hermantown 6, Creighton 3, that was an all Hermantown game.
What is it about? I said this to Pat Andrews after the second period of the Hill Murray game where they scored 2 goals and they scored 4 against Creighton. I'm like, well, you guys are a second period team. He's like, we can't get off these slow starts because they were trailing after the first in both games. And I just think that's just their depth. I think they're a very deep team. And that group's having a lot of fun. They're going to have a lot of fun this year.
Would you rather be a first, second, or third period team?
Well, third period, obviously.
I would rather be a first period team because a third period team, if you don't show up.
Right. I agree.
And so that I've looked at that before with teams. It's like, when do they score? Because by the end of the year, you can see, a pretty good outline of that.
Right.
And, if you look at third period scoring teams, one, either garbage time goals in the third period, or, you know, if you're relying on the third period to finally wear down your opponent, you got to come out more like Muhammad Ali.
I agree. It's interesting you said one of the stats you pointed out on this show in the last couple of years is the power play stat.
Yeah, that's an important
one. Phenomenal stat.
Yeah,
I really do.
If your power play is over, I think 30%, your likelihood
going
of
to state.
Yeah, going to state or at least your section finals is super high. And so I've done that research before, and it is crazy the correlation between that. And the only anomaly is Edina.
Edina. Yeah.
Because Edina doesn't necessarily – they don't practice it that much.
No.
And if you don't practice it, it is a very – getting goals, free goals when you can.
Right. All right, next.
Creighton 2, Eden Prairie 1, overtime, right?
Yeah. Well, what's odd about this game?
Creighton won.
Wow. You're not going to get a jersey from Funk if you keep saying things like that. I think what's odd is a freshman scored both goals. Nate Charlton, a kid out of Hastings, got his first varsity goal and then scores the overtime game winner. The kid's about 5'7", and he's just a spark plug and hardworking kid, super athletic. He's been an MVP in a couple of our events as a youth, so I've known who Nate was for a long time, and I'm just excited to see him succeed at such an early stage of his high school career.
I really view this game as cauterizing, you know, for the bleeding that was happening.
Oh, yeah.
I think this is an important win that they'll look back on later and be like, okay, you know, this is where we start to
ship right it a little
yeah.
bit.
Start to make some moves.
Interesting note here on Creighton. They lost Cernhaus to yep. injury, Devin Cardenas to injury. And
Cardenas.
I don't know if Cardenas will return too soon. I'm not saying he's out for a long period of time. He's getting an MRI. I talked to him quite a bit this weekend. He's going to get an MRI probably tomorrow. He did get x-rays and had no fracture. So... hopefully it's just something that you can work through and get back on the ice in a few weeks.
Yeah, yeah. And he's an important player for them as well, obviously.
I'm hearing this a lot. I'm hearing a lot of injury talk. And I think part of that is high school season's 25 games. And they play a lot of Elite League. They play Red-Black League. They play a lot of these other things that aren't as physical. And they get right into this high school season. And, boy, the hitting and the knee-on-knee contact and the – it's just a – you know, being at ice level like we've been the last 2 weekends, Carl, it's gruesome out there. I can see why there's some injuries versus the Elite League. No offense to the Elite League, but no one's killing you. You don't get killed in the Elite League. It's
– No.
Yeah.
It's a little different.
It's a little that way. Fair play type of thing. Orono 8, Alexandria 5, another good win for Orono. But one thing, we do have to figure out where Orono's goaltending is. because the Class A guy.
Is it Brock Payton?
Yeah.
It's something Payton.
Yeah.
My, he doesn't have a lot of work to do, but my financial advisor is Eric Payton. And we rarely talk about his son. I didn't know his son was a goalie until reading a preseason.
So, can you just talk to your financial advisor?
Yeah, I knew he was an Orono guy, and his kid played in Orono somewhere.
My financial advisor lives on the lake.
Yeah, no. Like I said, he doesn't have a lot of work to do with me. But, you know, the two pennies I do rub together, he does help me invest. But the point is, like, he never talked that his kid was this goalie and was really good.
He doesn't do his research on you either.
Yeah. Yeah, apparently.
Okay.
No, that's kind of a shout out to Eric. I thought it was kind of cool because we talk a lot about hockey and Orono comes up every once in a while, but he never has once mentioned his son was the starter at Orono.
Well, and he's not starting, so we don't know where
he's injured.
He's injured?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
We have an inside source for that.
Now I need to call him.
Yeah, now you have
Let's talk some hockey, Eric.
But first, let's talk about this.
Right.
Okay, Detroit Lakes 4, Kitson Central, which is now listed as Kitson County Central, but it will always be Kitson Central to me.
It's always been Kitson.
It's the whole thing.
Yep. It is?
KCC, yeah.
Oh, always really? Been, yeah. Oh, what? Yeah. Oh, okay. Well, I've always been wrong, and I can hang up the mic.
I want to hear, what was the score of this game?
4-3 overtime.
Who won?
DL.
I like this KCC team.
I'm the Bearcats.
But for DL, this is a slippery slope, too. In my book.
Why?
It's a section opponent, okay, taking to overtime.
Yeah.
If you're taking East Side to overtime to come back and, different.
It just tells me that the divide between East Grand, Kitson Central, and Thief River is not.
Yeah, it's pretty close.
It's pretty close. I hope you're listening up there on the East Side. You're no lock to get the 2 seed here.
And another top 10 team, White Bear Lake 5, Centennial 4. And
top,
over,
10, top, 10, 10, top 10, top 10, top 10, top 10.
Undefeated.
Okay. That's going to get old. White Bear Lake 5, Centennial 4 in overtime. And again, Centennial last week lost to Eastview 7-4.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. But you know what else they did?
What else did they do, Carl?
They beat Hibbing.
Oh!
No!
They beat Duluth East!
They beat Duluth East!
They beat Stillwater.
White Bear beat Stillwater?
No, Centennial.
Centennial. Oh.
I'm not here.
Yeah. Still not impressed.
Okay. Game I was at, Minnetonka 3, Moorhead 0, and it was a 2-0 game for most of it.
I listened to that one on the radio. It was a good broadcast.
The one thing of note in this game, Kai Weigel stick-handled around Javon Moore.
No.
Yeah. Kai is...
I want video of that versus the Albert Lee goalie.
Javon, went down to, try to steal the puck from the goaltender, and then Weigel just whoop.
Toe dragged him?
Yeah, just.
Whoop. We got to get this on video.
It was pretty funny. But Kai probably, he was at the blue line maybe twice in this game.
Goalies are getting more and more daring by the minute.
He played so aggressive, but rightfully so. He was on fire in this game.
I heard he made a lot of big saves.
But. Tonka, this might be the best forward class for Tonka since 2010.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. What was the forwards they had? They had Bobby Brink.
Low height.
Had more than that, though. They were deep. Teddy.
Yeah, and they had Bayless. That was a top line, very good. Very good team, and they also had...
You might have more, you're right.
Molinar.
Yeah.
But I think that this one, the 2010 team was very...
18.
Very,
I'm not going to argue with 10.
Yeah.
Not arguing with 10. I'm trying to think of their even more recent.
Oh, okay.
As I'm saying. As recent as 18, I thought they were good, too. But this group's good. You got Schultz...
Yeah, right?
You got Schultz and Lunsky.
Sheets is on the second line.
And Moore. I mean, yeah,
Krebsbach is on the third line.
I suppose. Yeah, this is deeper.
It's very good top to bottom.
With this is not a talents issue for Goldie. This is going to be a chemistry. Can they bring it together and work together?
And they really look like they are right now too. And I have a lot of confidence. And I said after the first period, it's like I believe the shots on net in that Andover game last week.
What was it?
That it was just like Andover put less than 15 on.
Oh, that's right. That's right. Okay.
And I believe that.
Yep.
You know, that wasn't a fluke.
All right.
That wasn't a bad counter, let's call it.
Like you ripped on the Wyzetta guy?
Yeah.
Wyzetta guy's come back fighting. Did you see that?
Yeah, I know.
Rightfully so. I like how a box worker can get after us and fight back.
Yeah, that's true.
I love it. Bring it on. I love it.
Wyzetta 4, Duluth.
Speaking of Wyzetta.
Yeah, Wyzetta 4, Duluth East 1.
Where was that? Is that up north?
That's Heritage. Yeah, I was there.
What do you learn from that?
It was very similar to the St. Thomas game in that, you know, it was a tight game into the third period, but like I said, East really started strong, slowly faded, like I said, slowly built, and they really had their depth wear it down. It was also very different from half East to play that a game, in that it was actually pretty open, up and down, back and forth. It was a lively, fun game to watch. It was not the like best you expect.
Plotting?
Yeah.
There's no plotting.
Why, a fun hockey game, actually.
Why is that it's going to play, like we said, a lot more open this year?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And they were, yeah. But also still not making bad pinches or anything to a double on the other end, which is aggressive.
All right. What do you got?
Hermantown 3, Hill Murray 1.
Clinching the Champions Cup title.
I think this is still a decent score for Hill for their second game out, just based on what I saw in Hermantown the first night.
All right.
Waconia 4, Cambridge Isanti 3, overtime.
I think that's one of the most important scores of the show.
I do, too. I think this is a big score.
I love it. I love that I have to go to Waconia.
Yeah, Waconia... Yeah, now we have to watch out.
When we were growing up, or my kids were growing up, and having to go to Waconia was like,
oh yeah,
from Bloomington, it was like, oh, we got to go all the way out there. I didn't really enjoy it then. Now I will. It's a good barn, and I want to see a Waconia game.
I haven't been there since my brother played for probably Jefferson.
I shot for Jersey Project. I shot.
You're murdering and shooting? Okay, yeah.
I shot, took photos of a Waconia Winona game there.
Oh,
I was the 507 kid. I'm like, I got to get Winona. When will they be in the Twin Cities? Oh, they're going to be. I shot that night. I shot Waconia, Winona, East Grand Forks, and Orno in the same night.
War Road 7, Matamidi 4.
Can I put a discount on this win? Or
will
I get hammered by my friends in World?
You will, but you got to do it anyway.
You will, but do it anyway.
Got to put 15% discount on this because, and I know they're going to get mad because I used the travel word here. They did travel, right?
They traveled on Friday.
East side.
Just excuse one.
And played a game the night before.
Yep.
And then played again. So I just discount any second game, and they played World who had not played a game on Friday night. So... a little bit of a discount on that win, but it's still a good win, though. And I think that, according to the Up North report by Willie P., Pilgrim had a hat trick.
Which is a good hat trick for...
Yes. Yeah.
Edina 3, Benilde 2. Benilde's
again,
first
this
game.
Is probably the most important AA score of the week, I think.
So this was Benilde's first game because the Chan game on Tuesday got snowed out.
Yes.
Oh, it was Matamidi. Sorry. Yeah. I said Chan because that was Shakopee. So, yeah, that was one of the other games I was keyed on.
Considering.
Yeah. But I think it didn't benefit Benilde that it was their first game of the year. Both teams were charged up for this one, to say the least. There was.
Oh, my God.
I mean, it looked like a textbook Edina Benilde game. Just a lot of.
It's
scrums
like that every year.
Every year. And it didn't disappoint in that department. But Edina jumped early. And it, also, that's a textbook Benilde folly, too.
Yeah.
And other thing is Benilde ran 5D.
Interesting.
Bumgardner's playing up on forward.
He played forward his whole life. He just played D last year because that's where Shakopee needed him the most. That's my
they might on. Need him again.
Back on D or Shakopee needs him?
Let's go with both. Yeah. Both. I'll take both, Alex. But I still think Benilde's the second best team that I've seen this year.
And Minnetonka's number one?
Minnetonka's number one.
So you're saying Benilde will rise in the into the top five?
I mean, they're better than their, 17-22 ranking that they are right now, probably?
Do they play Wayzata regular season?
13. Yeah, they play Wayzata next Saturday
that's a good
at 2:15 at Pick.
That's a good game.
Yes, good I will game. Be at that one.
That's a good one, that's for sure.
And then the last score of the week, Stillwater 4, Maple Grove 3.
That's another transitive property murder right there.
What, Carl?
Oh.
No, I have another score. The score. That's another team I want to talk about. So I was at a game.
All right.
Okay.
Duluth East Bemidji.
Grand Rapids won.
Who would they play?
Rapids beat East 3-2 on Tuesday.
How many in a row is that for Rapids? It's several.
That's a good question. It's a lot.
Yeah.
It's several.
I was telling Jazzy the confidence level is, you know, just it's over for East versus Rapids. Where, like, Rapids was always nervous to play East. I don't think that's there anymore.
No.
My comment on Rapids, though, is they have played four games. They have scored 8 goals. And they're 4-0.
Is that possible?
Yeah, but they
give up 3. Yes,
but they beat Forest Lake 1-0.
1-0.
So that's why
Marshall 2-0.
Yeah, Marshall 2-0. I like that's why I didn't have that score because I don't think Rapids is a. I love Rapids, but
right now they're the 2 seed in 7AA.
According to QRF.
Yeah.
According to any team ranking would have them as number 2.
Where's Cloquet? In this, if we were going to...
They beat Jefferson 6-0.
Did they?
I think.
Yep.
Oh, but speaking of
banged
up. I believe
they also lost to Hibbing.
Yes, that's why I asked.
They're 1-1. They've lost to Hibbing.
So I asked, Jefferson had their first game, the old, what was it, Two Rivers they called?
Yeah, Two Rivers.
Two Rivers lost, I think they ended up with 4 injured players. Not to laugh, but injured players. But, man, a team that was that thin losing 4 players just makes them even thinner.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, no kidding.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's all I have for games of the week. Tony, you want to take away our Summit Orthopedics Player of the Week interview with Andover forward Gavyn Thoreson.
Thank you, Danny. Now we're going to head on to the Summit Orthopedic Player interview with Gavyn Thoreson. Quick shout out to Summit Orthopedic. I had 2 of their surgeons come out to the Champions Cup this past weekend. TJ Delaney, who was an All-State performer at Rochester Lord, played Colorado College D1.
Oh, wow.
And is an upper extremities surgeon, so he does elbows, shoulders, and hands, so it was fun to talk about him. He scored a game-winning goal in the state tournament against Hibbing for Rochester Lourdes, and they took 2nd that year. So it was fun to talk to him. And then Dr. Pepin, who operated on my shoulder this weekend. So big shout-out to these guys. I mean, this Summit Orthopedics guys, they're like, coming in hard. They want to be totally
shoulder
involved.
Surgery this weekend?
No. I met my surgeon this weekend.
Oh, okay.
You know? I'm like, you're the guy who did my shoulder. He's like, yep. I go, was I your worst customer? And he goes, no, you were not my worst customer.
You're the guy that I saw right before they count down on me.
Yes, that's the guy. That is definitely the guy. So
that Lourdes fact was a deep cut.
Yes. That was all Peter, by the way. The minute he walked in, Peter started rattling off, you know, early 2000s.
Okay,
stuff.
Gavyn, welcome to the show.
Yes. Speaking of early 2000, it's 2004 birth year. Gavyn Thoreson, how are you doing today, Gavyn?
Good, how are you?
Good, thanks. We're going to roll up our sleeves today, learn a little bit about you. Middle child, so you're always seeking attention, right? Because the oldest got all the attention, and then your sister gets all the attention, so you have to earn it on the ice, right?
Yep, pretty much.
Tony's giving you children already here. So
That's right. Yeah, I gave you children. I always do the youth hockey memory, and I have tons and tons of youth hockey memories of you and Cooper when you were Squirts, and then at Pee-wee's up at the Big Pumpkin. You had a 5-goal game. I remember it was on a Saturday. Do you remember who that game was against when you scored 5 goals?
Yeah, Maple Grove.
Wow. That was good. So we're up at the Big Pumpkin, and this kid comes back who was doing some social media stuff where he goes, hey, did you see this Thoreson kid? He scored 5 goals. So I'm like, oh, yeah, I heard he had a big game. He goes, I have all 5 of them on my phone here. So we quickly downloaded them, put them up, and then some smart aleck, I think it was my son Jake, says, we should put that song Shots on there. And then it was shot, shot, shot. And they made this video out of Gavyn's 5-shot performance. What were you thinking? Did you see it that weekend, or did you see it when you got home? What were you thinking when that video popped up?
I think I saw it when I got home. I thought it was the coolest thing ever. Like, being posted on YouTube, I thought it was the coolest thing ever. Like, hopefully everyone's going to see me on YouTube.
Yeah, it was a fun day, fun weekend. I think that Maddie Kaiser was on that team, wasn't she?
Yep.
That's she plays for the Gophers now, and that was her one. I think she was like an eighth grader, but she had PB eligibility. That's all I remember from that team is they were a really solid team. So, Danny, Carl, you want to talk about the state tourney? Ask him some questions about the state tourney last year.
Sure. Yeah. So, of course. Gavyn, Andover has been kind of building for this for the past few years, right? So you would have been a freshman when your brother played in 2020, right? Which was number one. But then, of course, they lost.
Mm-hmm.
And then we had to follow it up. Second straight trip in 2021. Now it's coming in 2022. You're a fifth seed. You know, it's kind of a wide open field. What were you thinking heading into that tournament?
I think we kind of got screwed over in a way on the rankings because, we beat Crean, Hill Murray, maybe the World. If we beat all those top teams, and we were somehow still ranked behind them. So I think we had a chip on our shoulder going into that. And obviously, we got blown up by Moorhead earlier in the year pretty bad. So we just wanted to get them back really bad. And I think that just carried us all the way through.
Yeah, and that was one of those impressive runs where you're getting these very tight games, overtime games, where you're finding ways to win. Like, what was the attitude in the locker room there?
I think just everyone came together. All the guys just believed in each other. And I think Weston Knox did a great job leading everyone, keeping everyone on task and focus, telling everyone to keep going, pushing everyone to be their best, and it obviously worked.
Mm-hmm. Was the Superman Selly planned?
No, I was gassed, and I just couldn't think of anything, so I laid down.
You know, there was a lot of great Sellies in that tournament, but I think yours is the best because it was clearly not planned, and you didn't have any thought given to it, and it was raw emotion. You know, it was absolute raw emotion. Go through your head when there's 20 some thousand people roaring at your performance.
It was special. It was just like I don't even know how to explain it. It's just like blacked out. Like, it doesn't even feel like so many people are there, and it's just everyone's watching. You know, the energy in the building is just insane, and it's just like the best feeling ever. And I think that's why everyone came back, is because of that feeling. You can't get anywhere else.
Was that the most emotionally draining game that you've ever played?
What game?
The champ. Ooh, that's a fair point. So the championship game. Let's talk about the championship.
Was that Selly in the championship game, or that was the semi-winner, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was the semi-winner.
Yeah.
Quarterfinals.
Quarterfinal winner against Moorhead.
Yeah.
Well, sorry, I jumped.
There were so many good games, I can't keep track of them all.
I jumped two games then.
Yeah, you did.
So, okay, championship game. What was it like to be, you know, ice level on that? Because that had upstairs, that was crazy because the emotional roller coaster that was that game was insane.
Yeah, I mean, I don't remember much about that game. I feel like I was just going out there, I was gassed, I was just playing hockey and having fun. And I mean, just when they scored us and he doing the gritty just made everyone mad. And once he did that gritty, I knew we were going to win.
Wow. I didn't think we would get to the gritty in a Andover interview, but I truly appreciate that because it kind of was a watershed moment, right?
Mm-hmm.
I've said it before that those celebrations became excessive for Maple Grove, and I think that can get under the other team's skin in a very negative way, too.
Yeah.
It can change momentum.
I mean, he waved off his teammates, so.
Yeah.
And that's, I think that really, that's when it started to change, and then just momentum started going every time your line got out there.
I got a quick question here, kind of switch gears a little bit, go back to the family.
Yeah.
Your dad, Bill, has been a coach of yours, mostly in the offseason like Blades. He didn't do a lot of on-bench stuff with your teams. And now he's on the bench with you. Do you like Dad on the bench, off the bench? Because you performed well in Waterloo. You've performed quite well with or without him. What is it with him on the bench, or do you even notice that he's there?
I mean, obviously earlier in my career, I know she was there because he'd always get on me for doing stupid stuff, but nowadays he doesn't really get on me much and I don't really notice him. I mean, during the state tournament, he wasn't allowed on the bench because I think we only allowed to have like three coaches or something. So, I mean, he kind of stands by down by the defense, so I don't really see him at all.
When you were younger, he was actually the head coach at Andover High School. Do you remember those days at all, or had he stepped down by that time?
Yeah, I remember those days. I always remember going to the games and getting those broken sticks and taping up playing knee hockey with them and all that.
That's your childhood impression of your dad is broken hockey sticks.
Yep.
Let's walk through a little bit about this team this year.
So this year's team, it was probably more in doubt if everybody would come back and, you know, play this year. So, you know, you, Cooper Conway, Caden Casey, those were the big three question marks coming into it. What was the final nail that got everybody to come back?
I think me and Casey we decided we were going to come back. And then I think Cooper, once he saw we were coming back, I think he's like, oh yeah, I want to run this back. Like, I mean, teams have won the state tournament, but I mean, not many teams have won it two times in a row. So
did this fact enter your brain that if you guys can do what you just said, repeat, but keeping your line together, did it ever dawn on you? Someone told me this, a very well-known, well-thought-of Andover dad, not your dad, but another one, said to me, you know what? That might be, if they win state this year, that might be one of the best lines in the state's history. And I'm thinking of little Gavyn Thoreson. You know, I watched the Squirts play that line. I'm like, you know what? That might be a really true statement that I can't debunk. And that's a pretty cool thing to hear said. I don't own that thought, and you probably know who that guy who came up with that thought. But I think it's a pretty cool idea that you guys might be the best line in state's history, or mentioned at least in that line of thought.
Yeah, that'd be pretty special.
I mean, looking last night, the 2012 Benilde top line was sitting in front of me, and you know that was a great line. But to win twice is makes it special.
It would definitely be special. What are some of the things that are you guys doing anything as seniors this year different, or do you kind of take on the same role, or are you taking on an added leadership role this year?
I mean, we tried doing a lot of the same stuff last year, but I mean, we're not the same exact team as last year. We can't keep doing the same. We got to do the exact same stuff because, I mean, we're just a completely different team. So we've been doing some other different things, but, I mean, for the most part, a lot of the same things.
Talk about maybe some of the key additions this year. You got a really good freshman forward. Talk about him.
Yeah, he's a special player. I mean, he's like – what, like 6'2" as a freshman?
Yeah. Sour.
KJ.
Moves. Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, KJ. And I mean, KJ's just a great player. I mean, he's gonna go places for sure.
Is he the kind of kid? Here's a fun question. This is, I don't make this in the KJ Sour show, but is he a physical player, or is he just a shooter? What do you think? Because I know he loves to shoot the puck. How else do you see him?
I think KJ can be physical when he wants to. I think sometimes he's a skilled player. I mean, he has all the skill in the world, but I mean, with his size, he can be physical when he wants, and he's pretty good at being physical. So,
who are some? I haven't got a chance to see your team play. We obviously know about the top line and the new freshmen. Who are some other guys in your team who, if you're going to see Andover play for the first time, who are some of the guys we're going to look up in the program for your team this year?
Ben Dahl, I think he played in Elite League. Tristan May, Landon Stringfellow.
That's a good decor between those two.
Yeah, they're really good.
Is it just Tristan May now? We dropped the Robinson, or what's going on there?
I mean, we call him Tristan May Robin or Tristan May, but I think he still goes by Tristan May Robinson. It's just a little easier to say.
I had to broadcast him so many times, and then every time he get the puck, I'm like, oh, here we go again. I got to drop in this hyphenated name. That's how I remember
that.
That
sounds like a writer from the 1800s.
It does. Tristan May Robinson.
Yeah. Louisa May Alcott.
Yes. And then who comes in net? You replace the YHH goalie of the year, Austin Bronze. Who kind of fills that role this year?
I mean, our goalies have actually been pretty good this year. We have Bo Altman. He came in from Buffalo. He transferred here. And then we got Lil Conway, Cal Conway, and he's been doing really good back there. So, I mean, one of those two are going to have to fill their role.
Oh, that's good to hear. You guys want to move on to pick-ems?
Yeah, let's do some pick-ems.
Gavyn, you want to stick around and do pick-ems with us?
Yeah, I'd love to.
All right.
Well, first, I got some other games, Tony, this week that are of note. Chaska and Chan play, and then Chan and Tonka play. So it's a big week for Chan.
Section for
rivalry week for Chan Hassan. More
sponsored by Subway.
Sponsored by Subway.
Home Depot.
Benilde plays Andover this week, which are you looking forward to that one, Gavyn?
Yeah, that'll be a fun game. It was very competitive. We played them in preseason, and it was a very competitive game, so I think it'll be a fun game.
I think that's going to be a very fast game, too. You both are speedy teams. Yep. And then I got Hermantown and Centennial, some other Moorhead-Roseau, which is always a 6 o'clock rivalry.
And Roseau will win, like they do every year.
Roseau's quietly off to a decent start, too.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think they put up 7 and 9 goals in their games. I mean, it's not great competition, but they're around.
But that's kind of it. Minneapolis and Providence play, so we can kind of see how Providence, establishes themselves.
Yeah.
Not really much else. This is not as exciting as a week.
But some of these pick'em games are really good, including the
Pick'em games are good. I just don't want to grab them.
All right. Are we ready to go?
Let's go pick'em. Right,
we're going to go first. And we start, the old guy gets to go first in game one. Wait, before we do, how did we do last week, Kayla Jo?
Last week, we had Jason Shagabe with us, and he beat you all.
The guy who didn't even know he had a game on Saturday obviously knows more about us.
So he got all four of the games right. One game was
postponed.
But Carl, Danny, and Jason got Detroit Lakes over East Grand Forks.
East Grand Forks over Detroit Lakes.
My bad. And then Rogers beat Lakeville South. Carl, Danny, and Jason got that one right.
Yay.
Jason won with the Champions Cup because Hermantown won, and you all four picked four different teams.
Wait, Tony.
Yeah, we'll discuss that later.
No.
Did Tony not get any right?
Tony got one.
Rogers.
War Road beat Matamidi, and all four of you picked that one. So.
No, I picked Matamidi, so I got that one right, too.
You did?
Yeah.
I guess you got zero, then.
Spoiler,
sorry.
Man, I'm going to pick against Andover.
Okay, so that was where the confusion came, because you actually said War Road you said Matamidi first, and then at the end you were like, yeah, I think War Road's going to beat
him. I did, but I got to stay with the shtick.
Okay. Yeah. So I guess I was giving you more credit than you deserve.
Just for the record, I got painted into a corner on a lot of these, because you guys were such wussies.
That sucks.
Whatever. I don't care.
Sadness. I'm over it.
Okay. All right.
So you got to try and beat the guest this week, I guess. That's the challenge.
Yeah. Big shoes to fill, Gavyn.
Yeah, big shoes. All right, here we go. White Bear Lake, Stillwater. I don't believe Carl has this one right. I'm going to go Stillwater. And if Carl doesn't take White Bear Lake here, he's going to get suspended for a week. Go ahead, Carl.
Well, I'm going to take White Bear Lake.
Okay, good.
They're a top 10 team.
Good. Allegedly a top 10 team. Allegedly.
I think
the look on Gavin's face is like, are you kidding me? White Bear Lake's not even a top 25 team. That's what it looks like. Maybe that's not what he's thinking.
He scrimmaged them in the preseason at White Bear Lake because I was at that scrimmage.
How is White Bear Lake, Gavyn?
They're good?
Yeah, they're a good team. Yeah, they're good.
They have five left-handed defensemen, but they're a good team.
Listen to you, Mr. left-handed shot D guy. All right, let's hear it. Who you got?
I'm going to go Stillwater. I just.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right, Gavyn, your first kick at the can here. What do you got? Who do, Stillwater or White Bear Lake?
I'll take White Bear Lake.
All right.
I think I'm going to go to this one.
Good choice.
That is a good choice. All right, Carl, you're up with this barn burner that would have been a good game 2 years ago. Little Falls and Alexandria.
Yeah. Yeah, it would have been a great section game, but no, I think Alexandria's the better team.
All right. It was a good game last year, Danny. We were there.
Yeah. Well, it was a weird game. It was a five-goal swings.
Was there a running time?
No, it wasn't running time. Okay. It was five.
Okay, all right. Yeah.
It was a five-goal comeback, Gavyn.
Yeah, unbelievable.
Jeez.
And some of the worst officiating I've ever
seen.
Ever seen.
I'm going to go Little Falls on this one. I'm going to buck. I'll buck this one.
Okay. And then, Gavyn, you have Little Falls or Alexandria?
I'll go Alexandria.
Right. Any rationalization other than they're the same colors as St. Cloud State?
Ooh, good that.
I mean, they're a bigger city, right?
Yep.
That's good reasoning.
I'll take that. And I'm going to go along with the same reasoning as him, and I'm going to go Alexandria, too. I got to get some wins back here. All right, game three, Wayzata and Benilde. This game is at St. Louis Park, not at Pick, as mentioned earlier in the pod.
By a dumb person.
And dumb person gets to go first, Danny.
I'm going to, even though I said that Benilde was the second best team that I've seen, I'm going Wayzata. They need to prove themselves in section games, and I don't think it's here.
Okay, so you're going
Wayzata.
Wayzata. All right. You get to go next, Gavyn.
Wayzata. I'll go Wayzata, too. Wow.
Do you play Wayzata? Have you played them before? Yeah, have you played them before?
Yeah, we tied them last year.
Okay.
All right. All right. So then I'm going to go Benilde because my good friend Danny said they're the second best team he's seen this year.
Yeah.
Besides Minnetonka, so I trust you.
Yes.
And I'm going to go with that.
That's dangerous.
I'm going to go with that. Now, Carl, do you trust Danny or do you trust Gavyn?
I trust Gavyn and I trust Wayzata. You all know that.
Oh, that's true. Why would I even ask? Yeah. We just bypassed this.
Yeah.
Were you crying a bit inside when Wayzata played Duluth East last week?
It's like my two favorite teams. What can I do?
I know. All right, next game. Gavyn, you get to go first on this North Suburban battle between Cambridge Isanti and Monticello. Now, this is a true test. Like, do you know anything about these teams?
Nope.
Now,
me either. So, no.
Here's a question, Gavyn. Do you go out and watch other teams play?
I'd go watch like other big games. Like if there's like a big game going on, like Maple Grove or someone plays something good, I'll go watch those, but not like any like bad teams really.
Yeah.
All right. Well, these teams are not necessarily bad, but they are
just threw them under the bus right now.
Right. I'm just kidding.
No. I'm kidding.
Okay. Let's go with it. Who are you going to get? Cambridge Isanti right up the road from you guys or Monticello?
Oh, Cambridge, just because of what you said, right down the road.
Right down the road. I would have picked, because you went with Alex, the bigger team. I think Monticello is the way bigger school in this case. So I'm going to go Monticello in this one. And Carl.
I'll get on that Highway 65 train. And
go Cambridge?
Cambridge.
Yeah, I'll go Jackson-Seibel as well.
Really?
Cambridge.
God, you guys are just ganging up on me.
Yeah, I might be at this game. I have a feeling about it.
I don't know. I've kind of hit the wall. I've hit the wall, and it's early December.
It's week two, Tony.
Yeah, but I also have a 60-teamer up at the Super Rink. So maybe I'll go up the road.
Yeah, that's convenient.
Just run up there from Blaine. We'll see. All right, last game. Is this game at Rogers or at Andover?
This game is at
Gavyn, where's your
Gavyn,
game?
Where's
it's at Andover.
It's at Andover.
At the community center.
All right, so I get to go speaking first of Subway on this one. Yeah, really. They don't have this. The Subway's not there anymore, isn't it?
Oh.
Yep, it's gone.
It's gone.
Have they replaced it with anything? Is there a Quiznos?
Yeah.
No?
It's an ice cream shop.
Oh.
Oh, okay.
Good in the summer, bad in the winter, right? Or is it open during the winter, too?
Yep.
All right.
The kid on our team, his dad owns it, so.
Oh.
Really?
Yeah. Okay.
Let's give him a shout-out. Who is that?
Cameron Coe.
Oh.
Ghost Creamery.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And his dad played at Notre Dame, right?
Yep.
Oh. Okay, good shout-out. Good shout-out.
Jeremy? What's his first name?
Yeah, I think it's Jeremy.
Yeah, okay.
I'm not 100% sure.
Got a brother, little brother named Keaton, too, right? Maybe like a Bantam?
Yeah, he's really good. He's a good player.
Yeah. All right. I am going to go. Let's see. Andover Riders. I don't really know who to pick in this game. I'm going to go quickly to my rankings. And Rodgers is ranked ahead of Andover, so I have to pick Rodgers in the YHH rankings. Carl, you're the ranker here. Who are you going to pick in this Andover Rodgers game?
Yeah, I did put Rodgers number two this week, so I guess I got to go with the Royals.
All right, Danny. Can you stick with the shtick, or will you jump off, throw us under the bus?
Who won the home game for Andover in this rivalry last year, Gavyn?
Rodgers. Overtime.
Yeah, I was there.
Good
memory. I'm going Andover. I don't think you guys... I don't think you guys lose the back-to-back home against Rodgers. I just don't see it happening.
You have now met the podcast simp right here.
Yep.
He always kisses up to the guest. It's so sad.
Can't wait to see you this week, Gavyn. I will shake your hand.
So sad.
Wish you congratulations on your win.
It was a little autograph pad. Gavyn, can you sign this for me? I mean, it's good so Rogers pathetic. He's pathetic. God.
Hey, all right. Gavyn, do you want to pick Andover as well?
Yeah, do you want to pick Andover? Stick with it, you know?
Nah, obviously.
Really? Obviously. You could be the first ever guy to have to go back to his locker room on Monday of practice and go, yeah, I picked against Rodgers, boys.
One of these years, we're going to have an Ely kid the week they play Hermantown. We're going to make him do picks.
I'm going to have
Now, Gavyn, do you remember what Weston Knox said as he walked into the press conference and he pointed – and he said, never pick against the Huskies. And so you don't.
I don't remember that.
I do. Yes.
Well, good deal. Well, good deal. Yeah. Well, that puts a wrap on the show. Shout out to our sponsors, Summit Orthopedics, Red and Black Leagues, Jack's Cafe, and a huge shout out to you, Gavyn, for joining us and making this a great show.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
For Danny Ryan, Carl East, I'm Tony Scott. Thanks for tuning in. We'll see you guys around the rink.
Love is a burning thing, and it makes